like to make a call. Please hang up and try again.
Cristhian Bahena Rivera is accused of fatally stabbing Mollie Tibbetts while she was out running in her hometown of Brooklyn, Iowa, in July 2018. Rivera was questioned after surveillance video showed his vehicle apparently following Tibbetts as she ran. The victim's body was discovered in a cornfield 5 weeks after her disappearance. The following trial documents the state of Iowa versus Rivera for the charge of first-degree murder.
Kristina Steward.
And Ms. Steward, how are you employed?
I am self-employed. I own a hair salon downtown Brooklyn.
Okay, what's the name of your business?
Sheer Expressions.
And it's located exactly where?
Down on the one way, the main business district of town.
In Brooklyn?
Yep.
Okay. And how long have you owned that business?
It'll be 15 years this summer.
And is it full-time work?
Yes.
Do you cut
hair? For the most part, yeah.
Is that your job?
Yeah.
All right. Do you have other stylists that work for you?
I've had a couple girls in and out over the years, but right now I'm the only one there. I just had my last one retire.
Ms. Steward, did you know Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes, I knew her and her family.
Okay, can you describe what kind of relationship you had with Mollie Tibbetts?
Her and her brothers and her mom would occasionally come into the salon.
Okay, and so she was a client of yours?
Yeah, there was several times where I've cut her hair and her brother's hair.
Okay, and how long had you known Mollie Tibbetts?
I remember when they moved to town. They came from California, so to move from California to Iowa is, you know,
okay, so
a little strange.
No, that's okay. So thinking back, how young would Mollie have been when you first met her?
I would guess maybe around 10, 12.
She was still a young girl.
Yeah.
Okay. So you had known Mollie for quite some time?
Yeah.
And did you ever see Mollie or interact with Mollie outside the hair salon?
No, just at work.
Okay. If you would see her on the street, would you recognize her?
Yes.
Would you be acquainted enough that you would say hello?
Yeah,
okay,
or smile.
Maybe talk about what was going on.
Yeah, how are you?
Life. Now, on July 18th, 2018, at shortly after 7:45 p.m., were you driving east on 385th towards your parents?
Yes.
And as you were driving east on 385th, did you notice any person on the side of the road?
Yes.
Can you please describe for the jury what you saw?
A younger woman.
Okay. And did you recognize that person?
Yes, I did.
Okay, and who is that?
Mollie Tibbetts.
Okay. What was she doing?
She was running eastbound.
On 385th?
On 385th.
And how was Mollie dressed?
She was wearing black spandex shorts with a bright pink sports bra. And she also had the armband that held her phone that most joggers wear as they run.
And did you notice anything about her hair?
I noticed her hair. It was, like a low ponytail. As a hairstylist, that's usually the first thing that I'm drawn to when I see somebody, and I noticed that that was exactly how her hair is.
Okay, and did you recognize her as Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
How is it that you could recognize her from driving past her on 385th from the back? How is it that you could do that?
Just from seeing her around town, knowing who she is.
Okay.
She's not a stranger.
All right, and had you seen Mollie Tibbetts out jogging prior to July 18th of 2018? Had you ever seen her before jogging?
No, I mean, not on that road, no.
Okay. So whenever you passed, did you pass her?
Yes.
All right, where was she running, on the blacktop or on the side of the road? Do you know where she was at?
There's no like gravel shoulder, so it's just blacktop, and she was going up a hill, and as I was going to pass her, she was on the hill, so I was very cautious. I was watching for her, and I was, you know, afraid a car might pop over the hill, so I was cautious for myself, too, and the vehicle.
Okay, and where exactly did you see her in relation to the S-curve on 385th?
It would have been right before the S-curve.
Okay, And did you notice anything else unusual with Mollie Tibbetts?
No.
Was she running?
Just running.
All right. And did you see any other vehicles or any other persons around Mollie Tibbetts?
No.
Did you wave or honk at her in any way?
No.
Just to make sure we close this circle, was there anything unusual about Mollie or her surroundings that you noticed at all?
No, she just looked like she was going for a nice, peaceful run.
Could you state and spell your name, please?
Steve Kivi, K-I-V as in Victor I.
And who is your employer?
Powershiek County Sheriff's Office.
And what do you do for the Sheriff's Office?
I'm a deputy sheriff currently assigned to investigations.
How long have you held that position?
I've been with Powershiek County for over 16 years, and I've been assigned as an investigator for over 8.
And do you have other law enforcement experience?
Yes, I was a police officer in Iowa City for 8 years.
And what did you do in response to that call?
I went down to the sheriff's office and with intentions of trying to locate the phone or do something, but after talking to Deputy Simpson, that had already been done unsuccessfully. I was told that the search effort had been organized for first thing in the morning, and that I was supposed to start working on this the very next morning.
When you talk about the phone, what exactly are you referring to?
I thought we could ping the phone, try to locate the phone in an effort to find Mollie.
And whose phone were you?
Mollie Tibbetts.
And did you learn during the course of your investigation Mollie's routine concerning her runs?
Yes.
And what did you learn?
We learned that she liked to jog at night or in the evening, late afternoon, and that her routes would vary, but that one of her routes would be 385th Avenue that runs east out of Brooklyn.
And Deputy Kivi, were there any other agencies involved in the investigation or search for Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes. The very first day, the July 20th, we had several law enforcement agencies, our agency. We had assistance from Jasper County, State Patrol, DCI. I'm probably missing somebody, but we also had numerous volunteer firefighters, community members who were out searching road ditches, rural areas, fields.
Deputy Kivi, can you tell me what a canvas is?
Yeah, canvas it'd be an investigative technique that we employed during this time, where we went door to door, and I believe every residence in Brooklyn, trying to ascertain who lives there, who might have been visiting at the time that we believe she disappeared, any vehicles associated with the residence, and any video that they might have.
Is that something that was expanded beyond the city limits?
Yes. That technique was law enforcement related. We had other people searching fields and volunteers searching fields, but we also went door to door to farm residences, rural residences, and we focused our search effort in the rural areas. I would say basically in the, generally the southeastern quarter of our county.
Can you tell me approximately how long that process lasted?
At least a month.
Did you discover any evidence indicating where Mollie may have gone during the course of your canvas?
We had some initial information regarding her cell phone that led us to focus our efforts in that area. We had a team of law enforcement officers reviewing video from all kinds of places. In that particular video, the officers reviewing that picked up on a black Chevy Malibu that was seen in that area. And I'll back up a little bit. 616 East Des Moines Street. It's kind of on the eastern side of Brooklyn. And we believe that Mollie Tibbetts have been jogging in that area. And through their review of that video, they were able to ascertain that particular vehicle would have had to have been in the area when Mollie Tibbetts was jogging through, and most likely would have seen her. He was just kind of driving around.
I want to direct your attention to the following day, August 16th, 2018. And on that date, did you encounter a black Chevy Malibu?
Yes.
Can you describe that encounter for me?
I was driving north on Highway 63 in my county vehicle. It was a dark blue Dodge Durango. I was driving north on Highway 63, and I was going underneath the Interstate 80 overpass. And as I went under the overpass, I saw a black Chevy Malibu with chrome mirror covers at the stop sign at the westbound off-ramp. And it caught my eye, and I drove past it, and then I pulled over on the shoulder to see where it was going to go because I wanted to identify that vehicle and driver.
And had you been looking for black Chevy Malibus at that point?
Yes.
Did you follow the vehicle?
I did. The vehicle turned north onto Highway 63, so it would have driven past me. And I caught the license plate as it did. I ran it through our dispatch center, and I began to follow the Malibu north on Highway 63. I learned that the vehicle was registered to a female from Tama. And as we drove into Malcolm, which is less than a mile from Interstate 80, the vehicle turned west onto 2nd Street. And so I followed it. And then it turned north into an alley. And I lost sight of it for a second, but as I turned north into the alley, I saw that it was parked. So I parked in the alley, I got out, and the driver was already out of the vehicle. So I said, hey, can I talk to you for a second? And he turned around, and I tried to communicate with him. It became pretty obvious quickly that he didn't speak English. But there happened to be some older gentleman in a yard nearby that walked over and said he could help us communicate.
Were you able to identify the driver of the Malibu?
Yes. I asked him if he had any identification. He showed me a document as a birth certificate that gave his name as Cristhian Bahena Rivera and his birth date. I asked him, is this you? And he said, yes.
And what is this, Deputy Kivi?
It's a kind of a closer up picture of the same car. It appears to be focused on the chrome mirror.
Did you ask the defendant about Mollie Tibbetts when you encountered him on August 16th?
Yes.
And what was his response?
He said he had heard that there was a girl missing from Brooklyn, but didn't have any knowledge that would be useful to us.
My name is Derek Riessen.
How do you spell your last name?
R-I-E-S-S-E-N.
And how are you employed?
I'm employed with the Iowa Division of Criminal Investigation through the state of Iowa.
And how long have you been a DCI agent?
Since 1995.
What are the duties of the Major Crime Unit?
We are an assist-based agency, so when jurisdictions need our assistance with crimes or situations that they're not used to or haven't looked at in a long time, we will come in and assist them in any way they need.
Typically, do agents assigned to the Major Crime Unit work death cases?
Yes.
Including homicides?
Correct.
As part of your assignment in this case, were you tasked with locating surveillance cameras within the city of Brooklyn?
Yes, I was.
What was the purpose of that task?
The purpose of the task was to find any surveillance or any camera viewer angle so that we could better establish a timeline for Mollie and her disappearance.
Okay. And did that take some time to go through everyone in Brooklyn?
Absolutely.
All right, even though it's a small town, right?
Yes.
Still a lot of houses and a lot of outbuildings to check for surveillance cameras, would you agree?
I would agree.
All right. Were people generally cooperative?
Very.
All right. And did you and other investigators create a map with tags of the locations that you would have checked as well as locations that you would have needed to check?
There was. Within our meeting room, or war room is what we call it, there was a large Google map style. It was just a large, bigger than a poster size, that was up on the wall, which encompassed the city of Brooklyn. And within that, there would be stickers on each residence as to if they've been spoken to, checked for cameras, if there needs to be follow-up, or it's been completed.
I'm going to show you one of those maps, which is State's Exhibit Number 9. Do you see that?
I do.
Is that one of the maps that you're referring to?
Yes.
All right. And there are both, there's red flags that are on here as well as yellow flags, correct?
Correct.
Red flags indicate a place has been checked?
Correct.
Yellow flags would indicate you still needed to check that?
Need follow-up. Agent George, he came up and he had asked me what I was looking at. As I'm reviewing the cameras, I show him what I'm looking for. I turned actually to say something to him and he said, I think I saw something there. I thought he was kidding at first, but I went back on the cameras and then sure enough, we saw what looked to be like a jogger going through that frame.
It's from a distance, is that right?
It is.
This is difficult to see. Would you agree with me?
I would very much agree.
Okay, and if you look at my cursor, the what you and Agent George would have initially seen, would this have been the view you would have had?
Yes, that's Boundary Street down there at the end of East Des Moines. So the gray house you can see to the south, and then the white house is actually across the street of Boundary, so to the east of Boundary. So right along that white house is where you'll see a jogger.
And it goes by in a fraction of a second, is that right?
It does.
Okay. We're going to play this, and then we have an enhanced version of that too, is that right?
Yes.
I'll play it again here in just a moment, but let's be clear. What appears to be someone running is in the area where my laser pointer is, near this gray house, is that right?
Yes.
All right, does the runner appear from the side of this gray house and then disappear behind the bush that is here to the left?
Yes.
All right, we're gonna look at it one more time. Agent Riessen, based upon yours and other law enforcement's view of what you believe to be a runner, caused you then to do what with the remainder of this video, or this surveillance video that you had seized?
Essentially, what we decided to do was to start logging everything we saw on the video. Vehicles, any pedestrians, anything in and around that area prior to 7:45 and also following 7:45 p.m. as shown on the time and date stamp.
Did you notice what appeared to be a black Chevy Malibu?
We did.
why was it that this particular car, out of all the others that you would have seen, drew yours and other law enforcement agents' attention?
The big thing for me was when those four individuals who were viewing tape gave me their logs, I created a spreadsheet just on Excel, and with time and date according to the timestamp. And after the runner went past at 7:45:33, the next four entries in that log, once I compiled it, were a black Chevy Malibu.
And would this be the first time that you would have seen the black Malibu that you described in relation to the runner that we've already viewed?
It is.
All right. We'll play State's Exhibit 14. By the way, before we play it, looking at the exhibit, directionally, where does the black Malibu appear first?
The black Malibu will come from the same direction as where the jogger came through, so down by the gray house, traveling toward the red and white truck.
Okay, we'll show the video. Where my laser pointer at? What is that?
That's what we believe to be a black Chevy Malibu.
Okay. In looking at this photo, I've enhanced it just a bit on the screen, State's Exhibit 17. Can you catch the chrome mirror? Do you see it?
Yes, I see it.
And it's located here, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Where I've got the laser pointer?
Yes.
Very good. And going in chronological order, then, did you see the Malibu yet another time pass through the surveillance cameras?
Yes, sir.
And what street was that on?
I believe that would have been back on East Des Moines.
Okay. And at what time do we have on the date and time stamp for this particular video, which is State's Exhibit?
The time stamp on the video is 19:48 hours and 44 seconds.
Okay. We'll watch that video. Agent Reese, I'm going to play it a second time, but just for purposes of the record, generally, where do we see the black Malibu come from on the video, and what direction is it traveling?
It's traveling from west to east, so it appears near the red and white truck and travels down East Des Moines Street toward Boundary.
Okay. And we'll watch it a second time. Were we able to likewise take a screenshot of that vehicle that we just saw in this particular video?
We were.
All right, and what's on the screen is State's Exhibit 19. Do you see the black Malibu?
I do.
This is the black Malibu?
Yes, sir.
Do you see those same features that you just described?
I do, specifically the door handles and the chrome mirror.
We'll take a closer look at that. Do you see the wheels, the mirror, and the handles that you described?
I do.
All right, and okay. What was the last time that you observed this particular vehicle pass through the surveillance cameras at 616 East Des Moines?
It would have been at 8:07, approximately 8:07 p.m., 8:06 and 55 seconds, I believe. It would have been traveling from west to east on East Des Moines Street.
The same direction that we have here in State's Exhibit 19, is that correct?
Correct.
As a law enforcement officer, as generally in investigations, do you develop what are called leads?
Certainly.
What's a lead?
It's a piece of information that needs to be followed up on to see if it leads anywhere toward a resolution of an investigation.
Okay. Some leads are dead ends.
Sure.
Some leads are more fruitful. Would that be true?
That's true.
But you follow those leads as a law enforcement officer, as do other law enforcement officers. Is that correct?
Yes.
This information that you had on the video concerning the black Malibu, would that have been a significant lead to law enforcement?
Yes, in my opinion, it was.
All right. And particularly with regard to this car and the timing of when you see the runner, why is that?
The vehicle passed through numerous times after seeing the runner pass through the video. Just within, from the time the runner went through until 8:07, there was 14 vehicles seen on those cameras. Six of those were the Malibu.
Pamela Romero.
And how do you spell your last name?
R-O-M-E-R-O.
Ms. Romero, currently how are you employed?
I am the learning and development specialist at West Liberty Foods, located in West Liberty, Iowa.
Okay. And what is West Liberty Foods?
It's a turkey process meat factory.
And how long have you worked for West Liberty Foods?
It's going to be 2 years in June 26th of this year.
Do you have any prior law enforcement experience?
Yes.
Can you please describe that for the jury?
Yes. I graduated from Cedar Rapids Police Academy back in 2015. And I started working with the West Liberty Police Department for 2.5 years. Later transferring to the Iowa City Police Department for 11 months. And I'm currently a part-timer with West Liberty Police Department.
In your duties at West Liberty and Iowa City as a police officer, were you frequently called on to interact with Spanish-speaking persons?
Yes.
Both suspects and witnesses, I would assume?
Yes.
Did you have numerous occasions to interact with people in that way?
Yes.
In your law enforcement capacity?
Yes.
All right. Ms. Romero, I want to direct your attention to July of 2018. Did you become aware of an investigation that was being conducted in Powershiek County involving the disappearance of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes, I was made aware.
Okay, and were you requested to assist law enforcement in speaking to potential Spanish-speaking witnesses?
Yes, the first time that I got involved was with the Iowa City Police Department, and they told me that they needed assistance with the Hispanic community for me to go ahead and do interviews in Spanish.
And how many days in July did you spend in Powershiek County assisting in the investigation in that manner?
1 day.
Moving forward to August 20th of 2018, were you contacted by law enforcement in Powershiek County to come to Montezuma to interview a person identified to you as Cristhian Rivera?
When I was contacted, I was not made aware that I was going to go ahead and interview Mr. Rivera. I was down, or I had the idea that I was called down there to assist again with my Spanish-speaking skills.
Okay. And did you come to Montezuma then on August the 20th of 2018 for that purpose?
Yes.
At some point, were you told that you were needed to assist in the interview of the defendant?
Yes.
When were you?
When I got there.
Okay. When you arrived in Montezuma?
Yes.
And it may be obvious at this point, but why were you chosen to be the person to interview the defendant?
I was brought to the understanding that Mr. Rivera spoke Spanish, so me being a native speaker, it will be easier for me and him to communicate.
Okay. And were you briefed at the time by officers that were involved in the investigation as to what the facts were of the investigation to that point?
Yes, DCI agents and FBI agents.
At the time that you were requested to assist in the investigation, had the body of Mollie Tibbetts yet been located?
No.
Did you then begin to gather facts or attempt to gather facts about the defendant's possible knowledge of Mollie Tibbetts' disappearance?
Yes.
What does he initially say with regard to Mollie Tibbetts?
Mr. Rivera told me that he had no idea who she was, and she told me that he had never seen her.
Did you have a photo of Mollie Tibbetts that you showed the defendant?
At that time, I pulled out one of the posters, the flyers that had Mollie Tibbetts' face. I put it in front of the Mr. Rivera, and he looked at it, and he goes, "Yes, I have seen them around town. They are all over town." And at that point, he also added that he remembered seeing the Mollie's boyfriend at one of the local gas stations.
But initially, he denied having ever known Mollie Tibbetts. Is that true?
That is true.
Or having any contact with her?
That is true. He stated he kept a picture of, or the copy of the poster flyer in his car.
Ms. Romero, at this point, did the defendant then describe seeing anyone running in Brooklyn at about that time on that date?
Yes, he went on describing that it was a female girl running.
Did he say at this point how many times he observed this female runner while in Brooklyn?
Mr. Rivera told me that he saw her three times. He saw her first, turned around, came back. He stated that she even waved at him and smiled, and then he went back, and that is when he continued doing what he was doing at that time.
During that break, Cristhian Rivera placed into custody?
Yes.
All right. And did the interview then continue in the vehicle later on that morning?
Yes.
So later on in the morning at approximately 4:30 a.m., did you, Cristhian Rivera, or Cristhian Bahena Rivera, and another officer leave the sheriff's office?
Yes. Officer Kivi, an agent from FBI, and myself and Mr. Rivera left the office.
And where did you go?
We went to Mr. Rivera's residence and the farm that he worked at. I believe it was a property. Yes.
All right. That's an area in southeast of Brooklyn, correct?
I'm not familiar with the area, but yes, that's Powershiek County.
Then did you proceed to a rural area in far eastern Powershiek County?
We landed in a cornfield. Yes, that's where we were parked.
Okay. To the right on this photo, there is an opening to a cornfield. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And through that area, who was located there?
Mollie Tibbetts' body.
Did you ever go out to the location of the body?
Yes.
Okay. And were other officers present at this location?
Yes, there were.
Ms. Romero, whenever you got back into the vehicle, did you read the defendant his Miranda warnings?
Yes, I did. So inside the vehicle was Mr. Rivera, myself, and Sergeant Jeff Fink,
And did he waive those?
Yes, he wanted to talk to me.
All right. And did you then ask him what happened between he and Mollie Tibbetts?
I asked Mr. Rivera to give me all the details that he could remember since he approached Mollie Tibbetts.
All right. What was the first thing the defendant told you about seeing a female on July 18th of 2018 near Brooklyn, Iowa at or near 7:45 p.m.?
He told me he saw her running again three times. One of those times he parked his car behind her, ran after her or jogged after her, came close to her that she noticed him. She turns around, makes the attempt to use his cell phone to call the police. At this point, Mr. Rivera told me that he got angry and that is when they started fighting.
Okay. Now, what is the next thing that Cristhian Rivera told you that he remembers while he was on this road with Mollie Tibbetts?
So once Mr. Rivera told me that he got angry and he remembered them starting fighting, he stated that usually when he becomes angry or when he gets mad, he blacks out. So the next thing that he told me was that he remembered him driving and looking down into his legs and finding the earbuds that belonged to Mollie, and that is when he remembered that he had Mollie in the back of his vehicle in the trunk.
He did not tell you that he remembered putting her in the trunk.
He stated that he did not remember putting her inside the car. He did not remember how she got there, but he did remember how he took her out of the vehicle.
Does the defendant describe at this point any injuries to Mollie Tibbetts' body?
He remembers that there was blood. He told me that he took her out of the car, put her on top of his shoulder, carried her inside into the cornfield, laying her down, covering her with corn leaves, and leaving right away.
Tara, T-A-R-A, Scott, S-C-O-T-T.
And how are you employed?
I am a criminalist in the DNA and crime scene sections at the Iowa State Crime Lab in Ankeny, Iowa.
How long have you been employed at the crime lab?
I have been a criminalist since October of 2007.
Okay. I want to ask you a couple questions about weak samples. That's what you commonly call it. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is it common in your field of work and expertise to get weak samples?
Depending on the situation, yes.
All right. I think in popular media, people have the notion that if you touch anything, rub up against anything, cough on anything of that nature, your DNA is going to be left behind that can be identified. Is that true?
No.
Okay. What affects that?
So it depends on how much, if you're touching something, if it's a smooth surface versus a rough surface, how much pressure or friction, if you touch it once versus touching it multiple times, if you rub on it, you're more likely, the more contact you have, you'll more likely to leave skin cells there. For people who are nail biters or thumb suckers, you load your hands with DNA when you do that from your mouth. So when you touch something, that person is more likely to leave a sample than somebody who does not put their hands in their mouth on a regular basis. So there's factors like that. How long something has been out and exposed, there are things that will inhibit DNA and degrade the DNA to the point where I can't get a profile from it.
And were there other items in this particular case that matched the known profile of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
All right, let's talk about one of those, okay?
Okay.
I'm going to put State's Exhibit 46 on. Okay?
Okay.
We've had testimony that a swab was collected from this area, State's Exhibit 46, by Amy Johnson. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
And Amy Johnson is a co-worker of yours?
Yes.
Okay. Have you worked crime scenes with her on occasion?
Yes.
All right. the swab of this area that is right here is on the trunk seal. Would you agree with me?
Yes.
All right, and that swab that she collected, was that submitted to you for DNA analysis?
Yes.
This swab was taken from the Chevy Malibu belonging to Cristhian Rivera, would you agree?
Yes.
Were you able to obtain a DNA profile from the swab on the trunk seal that we see here in State's Exhibit 46?
Yes.
And were you able to compare that DNA profile with the known profile of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
What were the results of that analysis?
So the screening test indicated the presence of blood on those swabs, and the DNA profile that I developed matched the known DNA profile of Mollie Tibbetts.
Do you write it on a, what do you, how do you mark this area? What do you do?
These are stickers that are called tough tags, and that's what I wrote, the case number, the sample number, and then the date and the initials that I examined it on.
So when you have to go back and testify about something, you know exactly what you did and what area you tested.
Yes.
Just above this sticker, it appears that there's a hole in the trunk liner. Who did that?
I did.
Okay, is that the cutting that you took?
Yes.
Okay. And were you able to develop a profile from this particular area of the trunk that you were able to match to a known profile in this case?
Yes.
Okay, and can you describe that analysis, please?
So the profile that I developed indicated a mixture of three individuals. I was able to determine a partial profile at 20 out of the 21 locations that I tested of the major contributor, and that was consistent with the known DNA profile of Mollie Tibbetts.
Yes, my name is Dennis Klein, K-L-E-I-N.
And how are you employed?
I'm the state medical examiner.
And can you tell the jury just briefly what the duties of the state medical examiner are?
Yes, one of my duties is to administer the state medical examiner's office, which provides oversight and guidance to the county medical examiners. And we also provide autopsy service for about 80% of the state.
But part of the duties of the medical examiner, maybe one of the chief duties of the medical examiner, is to perform a forensic autopsy. Is that true?
Yes.
Can you please tell the jury, describe for them, and define what is the purpose of a forensic autopsy?
The purpose of a forensic autopsy is to document medical findings, collect evidence, and provide information that determines cause and manner of death for deaths that occur under medical examiner jurisdiction. So any case that would be of interest to the state would be of interest to the medical examiner. I was first informed by a telephone call from the county medical examiner, Dr. Paulson, in Powershiek County. And then I actually, my first encounter was on August 21st when I went out to the cornfield, the scene where the body that was ultimately identified as Mollie Tibbetts was found. The initial observation was there were human remains in a state of decomposition that were mostly covered by corn stalks.
Okay. To your knowledge, had any of the corn stalks been removed from the body?
Not to my knowledge at that time.
But does the decomposition process destroy the fingerprints or other identifying characteristics of a body?
It can.
Okay, and what about the blood that's in the body? What happens to blood in the body when it decomposes?
Blood starts to disappear, and even after a few days, sometimes it can be difficult getting any blood. And then by the time that a body is in a moderate to advanced stage of decomposition, there's no blood left for analysis.
Okay, and how would you characterize the state of decomposition for Mollie Tibbetts?
I would categorize her as a moderate to severe decomposition with skeletonization, meaning parts of bone were starting to show through.
At the beginning of the autopsy until you were finished, how long does that process take?
In this particular case, it was done in various stages. So the first stage was about 2.5 to 3 hours. But then because we need to examine the bones and have an expert in bone forensic analysis or an anthropologist, certain steps had to be taken, which take days to occur. So there were multiple stages of analysis, but that initial examination was about 3 hours. This would be consistent with a stab wound going through the bra and into the body.
Okay. There does not appear to be a lot of blood on the bra, at least visible to the naked eye. Would you agree?
That's correct.
Do you have an explanation for that?
Some of it may start to decompose, and it's also the color may also be hard. Perhaps with chemical analysis there could be, but it's certainly not visibly present. I agree.
Okay. All right. Any other defects like the one we see here in Exhibit 58 to the front of the sports bra?
Not to the front.
We'll move to State's Exhibit 59. What are we seeing here in State's Exhibit 59?
So this is the back side of the bra. This would be on the left side and left back side of the bra. And what I've done is I've taken white triangle pieces of paper and placed them on the bra where there are these defects. Again, these are all sharp force defects of the left side and left back side of the bra.
Are these sharp force defects similar to the same defect that you observed on the front side of the sports bra?
Yes.
So, Dr. Klein, we've looked at a constellation of injuries with regard to Mollie Tibbetts, and the constellation of injuries I'm referring to is on her chest. You would agree?
Yes.
Would vital organs have been affected by the object that would have caused the wounds that we've seen in these photos on the screen, 66 through 68 in the previous photos?
Yes.
Can you describe that for us, please?
The area in the body would be consistent with the chest and upper abdomen, and those areas contain vital organs, including the lungs.
And the heart?
Could be, yes.
Based upon your training and experience, the results of your autopsy, do you have an opinion as to the cause of death of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
And what is that?
Multiple sharp force injuries.
And based upon your training and experience and the results of your autopsy, do you have an opinion as to the manner of death of Mollie Tibbetts?
Yes.
What is that?
Homicide.
Can you please state your name for the record?
It's Heather Garvin.
And how are you employed?
I am an associate professor of anatomy at Des Moines University, and through the university, I also have a contract with the state of Iowa as a forensic anthropology consultant, given that I'm a board certified forensic anthropologist.
Sorry, I'm just going to request you speak a little bit slower.
No problem.
Yeah. So how long have you been employed as a forensic anthropologist?
So I started casework in 2005 as a graduate student at Mercyhurst College and been involved with it ever since. As of 2017 is when I became board certified as a forensic anthropologist.
What types of things can a forensic anthropologist assist with whenever a body is located and there are determinations that need to be made about what happened?
So forensic anthropologists are experts in skeletal anatomy. So what we do is we typically look at the bones, we're going to assess them, inventory them, and then reveal to the medical examiner any kind of evidence we can, either about the identity of the individual, if it's an unknown decedent, or the circumstances around their death.
All right, Dr. Garvin, were you asked to assist in examining the body of Mollie Tibbetts?
I was.
When were you called in to help review on this case?
So I received a call from Dr. Klein on August 21st about the case, asking me to be there the following morning, August 22nd, for the beginning of the autopsy.
Is there anything that has to be done to prepare the bones that are recovered from any particular person that has been autopsied?
Yes. So as a forensic anthropologist, I'm interested in the bones themselves, not the soft tissue. So after the medical examiner has completed their analyses of the soft tissue, we essentially place them in a heated water bath to remove the remaining soft tissue so that I can get a better view of the bones.
Okay.
It's called maceration.
Okay. And was that done in this case?
It was.
Is that a process that you do yourself?
I do not. The medical examiner's office does it for me.
Okay. In State's Exhibit 76, what were you able to find?
So this is a photograph I took of the right side of the head, the cranium, and the error there is indicating a sharp force defect that I found on the skull. It's just in front and above the opening for the right ear.
And does this particular area that you have identified with the area, does it penetrate all the way through the skull?
Yes, it perforates through the skull, and after autopsy, they did cut open the skull to look at the endocranial surfaces as well, and you could see that opening on the inside.
This is a bit of a different picture we saw than whenever Dr. Klein testified. You've placed some arrows on State's Exhibit 78. Do you see that?
Yes.
All right, let's start on the left side of the photo. What do the arrows represent on the left side of the photo?
So overall in the photo, we have the two neck vertebrae, C4 and C5, sitting on top of one another as they do in the neck. And we're looking at the anterior, the frontal surface of that. Anatomically, there may have been a little bit more space between them because cartilage would sit between those bones. So the yellow and the orange and peach area arrows over there are the right side of those neck vertebrae, and each arrow indicates a sharp force defect that I saw in the bone.
Just to make sure we're oriented correctly, the way that the bones are facing us here in State's Exhibit 78, it would be as if we're facing her face, Molly's face. Would that be true?
True.
Okay, not her, the back of her neck.
Correct.
All right. And the three arrows that you're referring to, are those all separate defects to the bone?
So those four arrows are all separate defects to the bone, but they all align anatomically with one another and could have been created with a single impact.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. So this could be consistent with a single impact of a sharp force blade?
Correct.
All right. Is it also consistent with multiple stab wounds to the neck?
All I can say is a minimum of one.
State's Exhibit 85 is on the screen, is that correct?
That is correct.
We've looked very closely at some of the injuries, or all the injuries, that you observed to the skeletal remains of Mollie Tibbetts, is that true?
That is true.
What does Exhibit 85 then represent?
So this summarizes the various areas that I found those sharp force defects. Overall, I had a minimum of 7 impacts, 1 to that right side of the head, 1 to the right side of the neck, the C4, C5 vertebra, 1 to the left side of the C4, C5 vertebra. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
Well, you would describe again, if you would, the injuries that you observed to the neck. The interpreter has to get it. That's fine. Just summarize it for us one more time.
Okay, so besides the one to the head, on the right side of the neck at the C4 and the C5 vertebra, I have a minimum of 1 impact. I have a separate impact to the left side of the C4 and C5 vertebra in the neck. I have a sharp force impact to the right 6th rib, another impact to the left 6th rib, another one to the left 7th rib, and another one to the left 8th rib. So in total, a minimum of 7 impacts.
Okay. Did you examine any clothing that Mollie Tibbetts would have been wearing that would have corresponded to those types of injuries that you reviewed, or is that better left to Dr. Klein?
I did not. I'm only interested in the bones.
Okay. So element number 2, that's right, element 1, ID, proven. Element number 2, cause of death, proven. Element number 3, this is one of two mental states that the defendant has to have in order to commit murder in the first degree. The first one is element number 3, which is the defendant acted with malice aforethought, a fixed purpose or design to do some physical harm, here to Mollie Tibbetts, which exists before the act was committed. The same injuries that were inflicted upon her prove malice aforethought. Now that we have identity, we know that it's Cristhian Bahena Rivera that committed these acts, that stabbed Mollie Tibbetts. He would have plunged a knife into her at least 9 times.
sharp force injuries to her neck and to her chest, which killed her. If that's not malice aforethought, I'm not sure what is. And really, the injuries to Mollie Tibbetts and this mental state that was used to cause those injuries that existed before he would have plunged the knife into her really is not in dispute. So malice aforethought has to be proven in order to be murder. So looking at the injuries, looking at the circumstances, the stab wounds, element number three is proven. The second or mental state that we have to prove is that the defendant acted willfully, deliberately, premeditatedly, with specific intent to kill Mollie Tibbetts. The same evidence that we have here, it's a little bit exceeding that because we can go back to the things that happened on the roadway to help establish what his mental state was at the time, the specific intent to kill. But the stab wounds here, the injuries to Mollie Tibbetts, what he did afterwards, he didn't tell anyone, all of those things, how he left her in the corn, all of those things, the repeated stab wounds that took time and effort to do. There's no other intent here other than specific intent to kill. There is premeditation, there is willfulness, and there is deliberation. He tracked her down, he found her on the road, he got angry, and he stabbed her to death, and he dumped her body.
Has the jury reached a verdict? And is the verdict unanimous? And has the foreperson, have you signed the verdict form and marked it in accordance with the verdict? With that record then, sir, I would ask that you hand the verdict to the court attendant, please. At this time, Mr. Bahena, I'm going to ask that you rise along with your attorneys, please. And I would ask that the court attendant read the jury's verdict.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Cristhian Bahena Rivera, guilty of the crime of murder in the first degree.